welcome everybody to Reclaiming MLK at the Institute for Policy Studies. Thank you for coming out. I know that it's later in the evening, so really appreciate everyone's interest and passion in being here. And I'm Mandisa Rothini. I am the New Mexico Fellow, and I was part of the Black History Month Planning Committee that put this together. It was a group of Black folk here at IPS, and we met and we thought about what our passions were, what we wanted the world to know at this moment, what we wanted to illuminate within IPS and to the greater IPS community and the community that we are within, the DMV and national and international, and reclaiming MLK was something that we are passionate about. We thought about MLK as someone with a complex radical vision, and it was important to us that what we saw as a co-opting and a whitewashing of his vision was really brought to the surface, and that we could not only interrogate that, but also bring forth his vision and again, its full complexity and the full ways in which he had a radical stance on the Vietnam War and wars abroad. He's anti-militarist, anti-capitalist. He was a proponent for Black workers. He was supportive of disciplined nonconformist. He was he had very strong views about white moderates and white supremacy, and many other things that often get lost in the retelling of MLK, which sort of seek to not only paint him in a way that takes away the crux and the teeth of his vision, which includes a radical redistribution of power, but also takes away really the vision of what was going on in his time with other social movements and other leaders. We have to understand that though today MLK is someone who might be considered safe, someone who is quoted in many spaces, that during his time, he was not liked. He is not someone who would have been invited to the White House. Today, I couldn't see that happening most definitely with this administration. He was somebody who was arrested. He was hated. He was seen as a threat. The FBI was watching him. So we got to understand these things and the radical nature of what he did and the leaders and movements around him. So it's also bigger than MLK, and we definitely welcome in this space those other perspectives, the critique, the praises, whatever. Also, while we reclaim MLK, we also wanted to reclaim the process of what that kind of dialogue looks like. So we were very thoughtful and intentional that this should be more of an interactive dialogue. We didn't want to have talking heads, even though our panelists have a great wealth of experience from many different spheres of work and life. But we wanted them to not only to be able to engage with that information, but be able to engage with you and the wealth of knowledge in the room. So the format of this will be is, I'm giving the short introduction. We will then have a short introduction by Mr. James Early about IPS and kind of just giving the lay of the land. We'll then have each of the panelists introduce themselves shortly, who they are, their work, and one thing about MLK that informs their work. So you kind of have an idea of where they're coming from. We'll then have a presentation by Dr. Clarence Lusane, who will contextualize MLK not only nationally, but within Black leadership, race politics globally as well. And then we are going to break out into groups, small groups, about six. We'll have one panelist to each group. And I'm going to have prompts and questions, and we'll go over rules of engagement when we get there. So I'm excited, and again, thank you, and welcome to Reclaiming MLK. Mr. Early?
Very good. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I am very pleased to have been asked to be a part of this gathering for a number of reasons, but specifically because the Institute for Policy Studies is an important progressive social activist, social thought and social activist space. An important social thought, social justice, social activist space, not a vertical institution standing alone, but a convening institution built around historically a fellowship of individuals who have honed their expertise from a social perspective, not just as individual scholars, but to try and understand the negotiation of power, the sociology of power, and various nodal sectors of what gives us a quality of life or takes away a quality of life, both on the national level as well as the international level. And that group of activist scholars are tied into a network of other networks of socially conscious people We're trying to understand the sociology and the interplay of power for quality of life, and to help collaborate and complement with organizations that are on the ground doing that work. As a contrasted often with the university, where individuals provide very important, in-depth, sometimes very profound analysis that are quite utilitarian for social movements. But the structure of the university is not generally that kind of space. I have a long history here at IPS as a young student of 25 years or so, I'm now 70 years of age, who was struggling with issues of racism and race and manhood, of how to follow my own aspirations and enter the public space. I was attracted to powerful ideas that were tied to social justice. And IPS was here, but it was a characteristically a white progressive organization with one particular Marxist, the late Sal Landau, whom I grew to be very close to, but I had to struggle with my own identity as one being marginalized and one who was trying to be centralized. That is, to put myself in the center of activity, not just as a Black man vis-a-vis whites in that particular instance, because we were not talking a lot about Latino or LGBT communities or Native communities in that era here in the United States. But it was here that I found an activism of thinking and turning thinking into action by complimenting people on the ground. It is a new generation. It is now your generation. You are the young, I emphasize, adult activists. Young relative to Clarence Lusane, who's a little younger than I am, and myself. But we now look to you to support and to compliment you in this kind of space. And reclaiming Martin Luther King as a social justice activist, not as an individual, but as a social individual who was involved in justice and activism and negotiating the issues of power at that time in a very complex society, I think is a very important undertaking. And I am pleased that you are here, and I'm pleased to be here to participate and to compliment with you.
Thank you, Mr. Early. And before I forget, I just want to remind everyone to please silence your phones. Of course, I'm not going to ask you to turn off your phones because we very much. yes, you might die, but we want you to feel comfortable to engage also in public scholarship on Twitter and Facebook if that's something that interests you. We have our Facebook and Twitter information back here. If you would please use hashtag ReclaimMLK, and of course, use our handle at IPS_DSP. Picture and image, that's great. Share what's going on in this room. And other than that, please keep it silent. So if I could have, starting from Tiffany, each panelist to say very shortly who they are, where they work. You can say as many organizations that you feel make sense, because I know everyone here has a very rich history. So who you've worked for, where you have worked, whatever you think would make sense for this forum. And then one thing about MLK that informs your work. And if we're getting a little too over on time, I'll just raise my hand like this. That means you have about 30 seconds.
Okay. I'm Tiffany Ward. I am senior legislative aide for Councilmember Mark Elrich in Montgomery County. I am also a proud founder of a teen program at a Boys and Girls Club in Washington, D.C. by the name of Kingman. I always talk about my direct service work because I think that's as important as my policy work. In the past, I've worked for AFL-CIO, doing voting rights work. I've also done other youth work around work and scholarship, as well as mentoring. How MLK has informed my work? That's a tough one. I feel like across my career, throughout my career, equity and justice has always been my goal. Whether it was I was working with Black kids in my old neighborhood in Shaw, whether it's, you know, if I'm working with workers who I'm trying to inform about the HAVA legislation in Philadelphia, and doing right now the work we're doing with the Fight for 15 there in Montgomery County, which is around getting workers a decent livable wage. It is far from the guaranteed income that MLK wanted, but, you know, believing that people deserve a wage that gives them dignity and an ability to actually pay their bills and pay for the housing that we're asking for. So on that, I guess his whole philosophy of struggle, of equity, of having the expectation of brown, black people and poor people having the expectation of being full citizens in the US has really grounded my work across, like I said, whether it's nonprofit work, policy work, or voting rights work.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Clarence Lusane. I'm the chair of the political science department at Howard University. Like James, my dear friend James, I was also influenced many, many, many years ago by Institute for Policy Studies, with people like Walter Rodney and people who were leading radicals of the period came through IPS. They certainly had an impact on those of us who were trying to figure out the world. And so for a number of years, I was also a board member of IPS. In terms of Dr. King, the one thing that has just always stuck with me and that I find as a resource is his courage. Mm-hmm. And that, and as James pointed out, at the time he lived, he took stands that basically other people did not take. And he took a tremendous risk, ultimately costing his life. But I always find that kind of inspiring because a lot of the social justice issues that we have to deal with require sacrifice, it requires courage, and people put their jobs on the line. You know, there's a lot at stake to take on the kind of issues that we do. And I understand when, you know, some people can't always take those kinds of risks, but when you look at people like Martin Luther King in their life, at least for me, then I find that as a deep well of inspiration to stand up for justice.
Hi, everybody. My name is Aleda Clack. I am a writer, sociologist, and author of The World Without Racism. I am an organizer in DC local. I did some organizing for housing and gentrification rights in New York. And then I returned here, and now I partner with the Future Foundation to do youth organizing and work here. And I'd say that MLK, Martin Luther King, doctor, informs my work as much as can be said that he does. It's definitely the justice and equity. And I come from a place where I take his definition of justice and I really dig into it. I think of justice as paying one time for every crime. So it's not just, you know, it's not repeatedly paying for the crime, but it's also like paying equitable, you know, what is equitable payment for this crime. So I do a lot of my work around leveraging privilege because I do come from a privileged background. And so I do a lot of that work around like, what does it look like for those of us with privilege to work in social justice environments and to use that privilege to further the legacies of justice and equality.
Hi, friends. My name is Ayanna Ford. My pronouns are she and hers. I'm the executive director of the Future Foundation, which you heard about for a brief second this way. I've done a lot of things. I'll just say that I have worked with almost every grassroots organization that has existed in Washington, D.C., and I have worked with every grassroots politician that has existed in Washington, D.C., including Marion Barry and his son. So with that being said, I've been organizing for about 15 years, and that was before we had Facebook and hashtags. So I would say that Martin Luther King Jr., Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I got to give him all his college credits. He earned it. He informs my work in a way that is a bit different than others have proposed in this conversation, but also in those same ways. And so I'll give you 3 points. The first is that he was very much mentored by a queer man of color, Bayard Rustin. The second piece to that is that he decided that he was going to leverage his agency and access for people less fortunate than him. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's to be noted that the internet wasn't around when he was organizing. And so he didn't have to get a job that was able to look up his background. Yeah. At that time. And so I say all of that to say that the Future Foundation teaches community organizing, social justice advocacy, and resource regeneration to future adults between the ages of 13 and 21. and their families. And so oftentimes my youth are just ready to sit in the middle of the streets. And so I have to remind them, how do you explain that to Sally Mae? I went to Howard. How do you tell Howard that? And they often go, oh, I didn't think about that. And I remind them that at the time that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was getting arrested and making all these other decisions, he had a doctorate. So at the end of the end, there was no internet or LinkedIn or Facebook. Facebook's only 12 years old. So I say all of that to say that I oftentimes think that we have to bridge the gap of understanding. And I think that's one of the things that he made it a mission to do and to be strategic in doing so. And so I try to model my work in that way.
I'll just say, so I'm on the board of the Institute for Policy Studies. I chaired this board back in the 90s for several years as I was coming out of something called the New Communist Movement. At the same time, I was working at the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Smithsonian Institution, where I retired from after 31 years. I stress those two factors because one can be a radical activist and also find wholesome employment. It's on you to find that calculus, as it was for Martin Luther King, and I'll just make this note, this quote, and turn it over to the next speaker, is Martin Luther King was a man of theology, a man of ethics and morality. That is where he drew his humanism from. But he was also a man who had a systemic analysis. And I just want you to recall this quote, if you don't know it, or remember this quote. Capitalism was built on the exploitation of enslaved Africans, and it continues to thrive on the backs of the poor, both black and white, at home and abroad. That's Martin Luther King. Those are quotes that you won't. So he always had a systemic analysis. But he engaged society where it was, not substituting his ideology for where they were, but informing and helping them advance from where they are with his ideology. That is an important calculus, I think, that we can extract in reclaiming Martin Luther King.
Hello, hi everyone. My name is Tay. I'm an organizer with 1DC, and specifically with the Black Workers Center. And the Black Workers Center is a space, a community-led space, where we build racial and economic justice through popular education, direct action, and building alternative economies. Talking about MLK, I'm a native Washington, D.C., resident, if anyone knows, but talking about what MLK and how it informs my work, I just think, piggyback off what the brother said right here, just his fearlessness. I can't think of anybody that several people come to mind, but Martin Luther King definitely was outspoken and speaking directly to injustices that a lot of people were scared and seemed like around this time wouldn't touch. He created a lot of enemies around this time, even in the Black community. And obviously with the infrastructure that was in place, the government and things that was happening, and I just appreciate the man's work so much, his willingness to go out and speak for the disenfranchised, the people that couldn't have a voice for themselves, and his struggle with the poor folks out there. That's worth one of my work over there.
Thank you. Y'all are real succinct. Again, I'm Mandisa. I'm the facilitator. I've worked in social justice and education for a while. That's my passion. I'm fifth generation Black New Mexican, so it's very important to me to, no matter where I'm at, to investigate history and to practice Sankofa, where you look back behind you to bring it forward to the future, to enrich the present and to enrich your future. And that always includes interrogating history, because revisionism is going to be something that shackles you as you're trying to go forward. So that's why I'm here today. All right, thank you, panelists. And we'll turn it over to Dr. Lusane for the presentation. I'll be controlling that, and I think we'll need to part the waves a little bit.
Again, welcome everyone. I'm gonna try to blast through this because, as Nadisa said, the main point is for us to be able to have interaction and discussion. Let me first say that I have a particular bias towards how I look at Dr. King And that bias is to look at him in terms of his international impact. One of the things that tends to get focused on is, of course, what King did domestically. But King, both during his lifetime and since then, has had major impact globally. And so I've spent the last 3 or 4 years documenting that. I lived in Japan for a while and spent time in Asia, in China and other places, looking at King's impact there. Now I'm shifting to looking at King's impact in Europe. King spent some time in Europe, kind of all over. But so my very brief presentation here will reflect some of that bias. So basically 4 points I want to make about King. One, his entire adult life, he was a critic of capitalism. And so I'm gonna give some evidence of that. As others mentioned, he strongly supported anti-colonial independence and anti-imperialist struggles. He met and consulted with well-known radicals, which was at the time extremely dangerous and threatening. And then lastly, he connected struggles. What we would use today as the term intersectionality, King practiced in certain ways. As I mentioned, I'm not gonna go into this in detail, but I want to give you a sense of how King traveled. So again, we think of King in a kind of domestic light, but King actually went around the world. He didn't travel as much as many, many other activists, but he went to Asia, he went to Africa, he spent time in the Caribbean, and he was in communications with people in other parts of the world. Again, people who were engaged in social struggles. The anti-capitalist King. He wrote, "I imagine you already know that I'm much more socialistic in my economic theory than capitalistic, and yet I'm not so opposed to capitalism. I have not failed to see its relative merits. It started out with a noble and high motive, but like most human systems, it fell victim to the very thing it was revolting against. So today, capitalism has outlived its usefulness. It has brought about a system that takes necessities from the masses to give to luxuries to the classes." When do you think he wrote this? 1952. This was a letter he wrote to Coretta Scott King when she was Coretta Scott. He was dating, right? But this is important because King was about 25 or 26 then. And even at that age, before he became world famous, before anybody knew who he was, he was thinking through these ideas. And these were the ideas that he took into the activism that later emerged in the 1950s. This is another quote from King. "We're saying that something is wrong with capitalism. There must be a better distribution of wealth, and maybe America must move toward a democratic socialism. Call it what you may, call it democracy, call it democratic socialism, but there must be a better distribution of wealth within this country from all of God's children." Essentially what James was pointing out. This was in a talk in 1966 to the Southern Christian leadership. So this was a public talk. So other times that King talked about his views on democratic socialism and like that were more or less kind of private. But King was increasingly, this was a year and a half before he was assassinated, King began to talk about these issues and see these links. And then King not only began to carry this out, again, King's last campaigns, if you look at 65, 66, 67, 68, after the Voting Rights Act passed, after the Civil Rights Act passed, after fair housing, all those campaigns, King said, "Our struggle is with poor working class people, particularly disproportionately African Americans, but this is about a class struggle. This is about poor people." So King was organizing the Poor People's Campaign, right? That was what he was spending the last year and a half. And again, as somebody pointed out, King had become very unpopular. There was a move to have King run for president in 1968, right? They did a poll, 2%. King had 2% of the vote. He had like about 40% of the black vote. Most black people didn't think King should run. So he'd become extremely unpopular, but King did what he needed to do. And then of course, the last campaign was in Memphis with the garbage, with the sanitation workers. And this was a very small campaign in a little city. Most people didn't care about him like that. King, by this time, was a global figure. But King did any campaign, worked on anywhere he wanted. King went to these black workers who were all men, who had been brutalized. A couple of them had died because they made them ride in the back of these garbage trucks, and two of them had got crushed. They wouldn't let them sleep in places because of segregation. Like, this was a campaign that King immersed himself in the final days in his life. And so that's what we have to reclaim, is that King was really kind of taking on these issues that went beyond the civil rights, that went to the core of working people in this country. King was also anti-colonial, pro-independence. This is a statement: Ghana represents the victorious sector in the worldwide movement of colonial people towards the dawn of freedom. Our own struggle in the United States is a part of this great democratic upsurge. King went to Ghana in 1957. He was at the independence celebrations for Ghana, which was the first African country to become independent in that period. And he stood next to and associated with Kwame Nkrumah, who was the leader of that time, and Nkrumah, who was evolving a view of uniting all of Africa, right, that King, again, kind of united with. Now, most notable is King's positions, his evolved position towards the Vietnam War. And most people think of it as the speech that he gave April 4th, 1967, but as early as 1965, he began to publicly talk about the Vietnam War being wrong, and that the civil rights movement, civil rights leaders, black community have to take a stand. August 65, January 66, February 67. Okay, so how did King get here? So King wasn't just influenced by the anti-war movement in the United States, but actually was in touch with people in Vietnam. In June 1963, there was a very famous incident where monks set himself on fire. And then there was a series of those self-immolations that happened. And King could not understand why people would do this. So Thich Nhat Hanh, whose name I might be mispronouncing, who was a young radical monk in Vietnam, wrote to King. And this is him. He's still alive, actually. He's very well known for a lot of the therapeutic and healing kind of work that he does today. He wrote to King, said, "I believe with all my heart that the monks who burned themselves did not aim at the death of the oppressors, but only at changing their policy. I also believe with all my being that the struggle you lead in Birmingham, Alabama, is not aimed at whites, but only at intolerance, hatred, and discrimination. I'm sure that since you have been engaged in one of the hardest struggles for equality and human rights, you're also among those who understand fully, who share all the hearts, the indescribable suffering of the Vietnam people. The world's greatest humanists would not remain silent. You yourself cannot remain silent." So King took this to heart. And King, again, began to speak out about the war in Vietnam. King became very close with Han. He was the only person that Martin Luther King nominated for Nobel Peace Prize in 1968. Under the Nobel Peace Prize Committee rules, there are certain people who can make nominations. One is people who are former winners. But King believed that the work that Han was doing, not just in Vietnam, but globally around peace, was of such importance that King nominated him for the Nobel Peace Prize in 1968. Of course, April 4th, 1967, this is the 50th year anniversary, King gave his Time to Break Silence speech in New York. And this was a critical break from US policy that put King in the crosshairs. And not only did the state go against King, but virtually the entire civil rights movement. Now, there were radicals, there was the Black Panthers, there were the folks in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So there were people who had been on that side, but the folks that King had been with, the funders, all of that stuff fell apart. Books book contracts were canceled, speaking engagements were canceled. There was tremendous pressure on King, and King only got stronger. He only said, "You know, I'm just beginning, right? I am going down a whole road with this." Now, I also want to point out, Coretta was also engaged in the anti-war movement. So, you know, she gets marginalized in ways because, you know, how we deal with women's role in all of this. But in 1964, even before King spoke out, Coretta was at anti-war rallies, and Coretta began to speak out and talk about the war, working with the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, which was an anti-war, anti-imperialist organization. This is her speaking about a week or two after King had delivered his time to break silence speech out in San Francisco. And this is her speaking a few weeks after King was assassinated. Right, so she didn't go and hide and, you know, moan. She did moan, of course, but she was like, these issues have to continue. We have to continue to be engaged. And then King, in many ways, again, the term we use is intersectionality, in a number of instances, including at his Nobel Prize lecture in 1964 in Oslo, linked racism, materialism, and militarism. Racism, poverty, capitalism, he saw as linked. They were not separate struggles, but ones that all came together. He said this a number of different times kind of along the way. And the last thing I mentioned is the people that King hung out with, right? These are people that today would probably get King sent to Guantanamo, right? Because these were the radicals of the time. Henry Belafonte, former board member of IPS, but who since the 1950s has been on the front line on every issue you can imagine. And again, reflecting that courage that we saw in King. C.L.R. James. How many of you guys know who C.L.R. James is? Okay, C.L.R. James was a scholar from the Caribbean, but probably the most prolific and certainly one of the deep thinking radicals of the 20th century, who operated on four different continents, lived to be in his late 90s, was here in Washington, D.C. for a long time, but was one of the brilliant scholars of the century. This is somebody that King met with, talked to, consulted with.
Socialist.
Jack O'Dell. Jack O'Dell was one of King's aides, brilliant guy, both on domestic and foreign policy. He eventually was his foreign policy person, played the same role for Jesse Jackson during Jesse Jackson's campaigns when he ran for president. But Jack O'Dell, when he was younger, had been in the Communist Party. And that became an issue for the Kennedys. And there's a very famous meeting where Kennedy took Martin Luther King into the Rose Garden because he didn't trust the FBI. He thought J. Edgar Hoover was bugging the White House, and he was right. He took King into the Rose Garden and said, for your civil rights agenda, you got to get rid of this guy. And this was like the guy who was running their fundraising campaigns. He said, you've got to get rid of this guy. King said, okay, King lied. Right, King, but he's like, this is my guy, you know, I just tell Kennedy, whatever, but he kept him on, right? In part for principle, that, you know, you basically can't tell me who I can hire, who not, but also Jack O'Dell was such an important factor in what King was doing. And again, there, the FBI files on these three guys alone probably goes into millions of pages. He hung out with the American Friends Service Committee, right? Radical Quaker organization, going back hundreds of years. It was AFSC that actually nominated King for the Nobel Peace Prize, right? Women's Strike for Peace, American Committee on Africa. These were the associations that King linked himself to, all of which cost him dearly in terms of how he was seen by the state and in many ways how he was seen by the conservative forces in the civil rights movement. All right, so just a couple closing points. King was evolving a paradigm, I would argue, that linked domestic and international issues and how that fit in with a strategy around nonviolent direct action. And there's a lot in terms of who King was studying and reading during this period, we can talk about later. That paradigm continues today. And again, this is again some of the work I'm doing. Around the world, there are direct references to King and the work that he did in Hong Kong, in Tibet, in Berlin, all over the world. People are still accessing King and what he was evolving as a thesis for how you bring about social change. And then lastly, all of this is in part of a movement for global social justice. All right, thank you.
We got all our panelists, yes. So for the interactive part of this, we'll break into groups in here a second. I first wanted to lay some rules of engagement and open up about a minute if anyone has any extra ones that are important to them. First, we're gonna do six groups. There's enough people to have one panelist per group, so we'll have about 3 to 4 people. I think that's good. Sound good to everybody? Because we have rich discussion. Make sure that you speak from the I. From your experience, from what you know, from what you've read, don't assume what other people feel or think. Make sure that if you usually speak, that you step back. And if you're usually quiet, please step up. Disagreement can, of course, foster growth, but disagree respectfully. Give everyone a chance to speak. And please make sure you designate someone to share back what the group discussed. As far as that part, the person that will be sharing back fully, verbally, will be the panelist member in your group. But we do need someone designated who has relatively good handwriting to write on the giant sticky note that I'll give you some of your notes as you go along. And each of the panelists, they have these with them. They have 2 copies in their folder. They have the instructions, which is for each quote, discuss the following questions in your group. And everyone has a quote in their folder. And we also have the quotes up here. So you have, again, the quote in your folder, and you can pick 1 or 2 or however many you get through. And the first question for each quote is, how does this inform current American policy and politics today? Second, does this quote reclaim MLK? Why or why not? Does it offer a more complex and radical understanding of MLK's mission, vision, before you understood it before today? And third, how does this quote inform your work in your community or in your studies towards a more just world? And that's really important because we want to understand that we're also having this moment so that we can have action. We can reflect, we can come together, but then we can act. Any questions or anything we should add to the rules of engagement? All right, time. We are at 6:47, so we're doing good. That means that we have 30 minutes. Thank you, Quisha. Quisha's always timely. Everyone was real succinct, so we were going to as well.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for discussion. You can stay where you are. That's fine. I just need people up here to scooch back, and I need the panelists to come forward so that they can share back what the groups talked about. Just if anybody comes up, they're going to be filmed. So that's okay. Yeah, you may have to find another chair.
Oh, that's fine. That's fine.
I'm ready for you. Let me know. So I forgot to mention that we not only are recording this event so that you can watch it later and that, you know, it's in our archives, but we are also live streaming it to a class at Winston-Salem University, an Africana Studies class. They have been watching the presentation with us. They also did the breakout groups with us, and they might be able to, if they type back comments. Mimi is going to share back some of their reflections, and they also use the hashtag ReclaimMLK and the handle IPSDC. So if you search either of those, you can kind of look at the discussion they were having, as well as I noticed a lot of people in the room were posting stuff. So that's something good to look back at. So for this last 10 minutes, any way that makes sense, summarize what your group discussed. And then also this is a space panelist to do your closing remarks. So do your summary. And then do your closing remarks, and then we'll move on to the next person until it's over. You can have your group members help you, but of course, disclaimer, this is being recorded in live stream. So if you're going to help one of the panelists, you will be the first. All right. We'll start on this end.
And if they request, do they need to come up front?
Yes, if you want to be, no. Just make sure you project. Project, okay.
You said closing argument, evidence, which you actually asked.
Oh, well, closing remarks, just anything that you wanted to conclude.
Okay.
Based on your experience today or about MLK, any knowledge that you gained or something you wanted to impart, whether from your group discussion or something that you wanted to
okay,
hit on.
And I'm going to touch on each question that we just not have. Okay, so
thank you.
So our quote that we were signing was, it says, freedom is never voluntary given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. And that was from a city jail in 1963. And our first question was, how does it inform current American policy and politics today? And as you can see, we it came up, we was talking about like the travel ban and how people are taking to the streets now and demanding and actually had this wake up call where they realizing that they must take action into their own hand and go out and get for what they want. Also, we have another question that says, does this quote reclaim MLK? Why or why not? Does it offer more complex and radical understanding of MLK vision? And we had mixed feelings about it. We were very ambivalent because like together, the group, it's like we acknowledge that he might have been in like a very scrutinized position. Like he's probably facing a whole lot of sensitivities all around him. And the fact that he didn't just explicitly claim like to this quote, he didn't explicitly, wasn't so extreme. Cause it was like, it demand, the fact that that key word demanded, it wasn't taken. And I think some people would have been more appreciative to the word taken versus demanded. That's what one of the folks said. How does this a quote inform your work in community or is it in your studies just more? We also pointed out how does this quote so we took okay, so we acknowledge that no progress is made without struggle, action oriented, not dependent on policymakers. Trump freedom, I think we kind of, I kind of touched on that a little bit with the anti-Muslim ban and the fact that people taking the things in their hand. Also, we did speak a little bit of this, do everybody have a paper? No, everybody don't have a paper. Talking about over the past few years, I have been gravely disappointed with the white moderate.
Yeah, that's right.
That question. Yeah. So we did touch on it a little bit, right? Am I still?
Yeah,
okay, we touched on that a little bit. And like, I think for the most part, all of us came to the same conclusion. It just brought up liberalism and the fact that people hold these positions where they just acting like they don't see what's going on in the room. They just choosing this position of not picking a side, and it doesn't work. And it's very dangerous to the average working people that's depending on them to say something and help out the rest of the people that's suffering. So you know, that's how I would do.
Thank you. Did you have any closing remarks?
I just think I'm just touching back on what the question that I just now answered. And I'm just thinking, you know, how much I would just love to see people just stand up. I can't never understand how people could keep on keeping this man in high regards and all these revolutionary people, and they constantly keep on bombarding us and talk about how great these people are, yet they do not seem to respect or acknowledge the politics and the things that this man have fought for. And they just take this approach where they don't, they scholarly yet ignorant of what's going on. I'm just confused, I guess. So.
No, you're not. You have nailed it.
Yeah, so I'm gonna pass it on to the next.
This was a very rich discussion and very difficult to put in digest form, and I will follow the framework that has just been laid out by going to the particular quote before I go to the quotes that we all shared. Our particular quote was, somebody told a lie one day. They couched it in language. They made everything black, ugly, and evil. Look in your dictionary and see the synonym of the word black. It's always something degrading, low, and sinister. Look at the word white. It's always something pure, high, clean. Well, I want to get the language right tonight. Want to get the language so right that everybody here will cry out, yes, I'm black. I'm proud of it. I'm black and beautiful. Martin Luther King Jr. And we discussed that this is succinctly laid out in the Donald Trump ultra-nationalism, intolerance, authoritarianism, I'm in charge. When he refers to the African-American community or to the Black community, it is without class distinctions, it is without achievement, it's all a deficit. And by implication, other communities, whether they are LGBTQT, whether they are non-Christian, whether they're Muslim, whether they're immigrants, it's all negative. And that I'm Black and I'm proud has a particularity of the Black experience, but Black Lives Matter is a manifestation in its various expressions of not only defending the Black community, but it has a program that looks systemically at how the system operates for all. And it explicitly says, obviously this is about us to protect us, but it's about all of us who are under. So we think that this quote does fit inform the current American policy and politics. The other quote, I won't try to go through each of them, and I'll ask the fellow panelists if this is a balanced approach. A true revolution of values will soon look uneasily on the global contrast of poverty and wealth with righteous indignation. King was looking at a system, not just at an individual issue. And that today's reflection in many different ways of the mass protests that we see in the streets today are looking at various elements of the system and finding intersectionality to be more conscious of how they each are connected. So that's how it informs current American policy and politics. Does the quote reclaim King? And this is something we said about each quote. We suggested that it recenters King. It is up to us to reclaim him, but it recenters him in this cross-sectionality of response to a system that is failing. And it is up to us to reclaim him in the way that he worked with patients with different ideologies, but in the middle of ordinary people. And that's not a summary of the richness of our discussion. So I will ask our fellow group members if, okay, that's it.
We approve.
Ditto. Very good.
Any other closing remarks?
I guess my closing remark would go back to the one issue that I think we did a very good job, and that is about the quote, over the past few years, I've been gravely disappointed with the white moderate. I've almost reached a regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in the stride towards freedom is not the White Citizens Council or the Ku Klux Klan, but the white moderate. And in many ways, that is very still true. Robert Reich on Move On is saying, we've got to push the Senate, which is essentially a group of white men, because they're using an old toolkit. But we also said that this needs to be complicated, because white moderates, in a way, set the standard. Please correct me if I'm wrong here. They are moderates in all of our communities who follow that same kind of incrementalist standard. So it is not a simple equation of black and white, of black and white and non. It this issue of moderateness, and could we have to look at it beyond the color question, but also within our own communities. And the last thing I would say is that it's your world, particularly the young adults in this room. We who have come before, who have children your age, adult children your age, we're here to support and compliment, and we will be honest and forthright. But you really are the engines of your time. And as someone who was associated with IPS, you are the ones you've been waiting for.
Thank you. We also had a rich conversation. In order, I'll start with the original quote that we had that differentiated from the other groups. One day, we must ask the question, why are there 40 million poor people in America? And when you begin to ask that question, you're raising questions about the economic system, about a broader distribution of wealth. When you ask that question, you begin to question the capitalistic economy. You begin to ask the question, why is it that people have to pay water bills in a world that is 2/3 water? Martin Luther King Jr., where do we go from here? Chaos or community, 1967. So again, the first question is, how does it inform current American policy and politics today? I'll just leave you with Flint, and that there are so many other Flints. And I'll tell you, as a native Washingtonian, come on, sis, that's what I was about to say. I grew up all my life knowing you don't drink DC water, because we were a Flint, we never sought help for it. For those of you who frequent a business that's very well known here, they have a drink called DC tap water. Mm-hmm. And if you have the DC tap water, you'll notice that it's a very odd color. Mm-hmm. That's an ode to our Flint here in DC. Currently Pittsburgh, and I have some organizer friends in Pittsburgh right now are dealing with them bleaching their water. So just saying that to say that these are local fights that are happening right now that I'm quite sure you may not know about. But what we did differently, and I'm not sure how other groups facilitated, but each individual in our group took a quote, owned that quote, shared their analysis for that quote. And so with this quote specifically, the living wage fights are continued challenges within radical spaces. Again, Flint is a real-time example, but more communities are affected by inadequate water supplies and such. As far as does this quote reclaim MLK, the agreement was yes. That this constantly challenges us to rethink how we are framing conversations on equity. And then the third piece to that is that the individual who had this quote works in criminal justice, and that current conversations around divestment, around innovation, around what are we saying and how are we doing this work, are often met with stagnant responses. And so that was so poignant to me, because one of the things we talked about in the group was how some of us have been organizing before there were hashtags for it. And so when it's not a trending topic, how do you combat, you know, apathy? How are you looking at stagnation? How are you making sure that it's intergenerational? And so some of these things were answered and honored in the other comments that were made that I'd love to share with you. One of the thoughts from the quote about Vietnam was that when we're having conversations about King and the different thoughts that King had, one, that quote regarding Vietnam really dispelled a lot of the myths about the benefits of colonialism that we like to embrace when we talk about our upbringing. And that while it does reaffirm and reclaim MLK, we've got to refuse to cherry pick how we're looking at our icons and our leaders. With the letter from Birmingham, again, we talked about the cherry picking of our leaders, and that with the conversations about the moderate white individuals, we're currently living that, and it could be our demise. And then the last piece that I thought was very important that was brought up was that in the last three elections we've had, so the two that resulted in Barack Obama's election and the one that resulted in he who must not be named election, we were looking for nonconformists in all of those elections. They were won by voters who were looking for someone that did not seem to be the go-to politician. And so that work could either be done for our benefit or to our own demise. And I'll leave those points with one of the greatest things that came out in the group before I make my closing comment, was that so often, not only have we cherry-picked MLK, but we cherry-pick all of our leaders. And that in the same regard that we uplift and we celebrate Martin Luther King, you hear about Malcolm X, but you don't hear about El Malik, you know, Shabazz. They don't uplift that before he died, he was an Orthodox Muslim man of color. You hear so many conversations about the men who led the civil rights movement, but you don't hear about the women who led the civil rights movement, you know, Fannie Lou Hamer, so many great people who sat on the back burner because they felt it'd be more important not to be seen and to just be heard. And so with that being said, just like Mr. Early said, I do work with what we identify as future adults and their families. They are 13 years old to the ages of 21 years old. In DC, youth are identified as up to 24.
So we do have some 24 years olds that we also work with as well. It takes a lot of money. We're based in Ward 8, so we have one grocery store in Ward 8. There are no chain businesses in Ward 8. There are very few small businesses and absolutely no job opportunities in Ward 8 if it doesn't come from the DOES van, and it's called the Does Nothing van, where we come from. Some have heard about, you know, the fight for Berry Farms. We are the only organization that touches Berry Farms every week. Our programs, we were asked by the community to move. Our programs are rooted at the Berry Farms Recreational Center. I say that to say it takes resources to do this work. Leda spoke earlier about how she works with the Future Foundation, but the reality is we need everybody to work with the Future Foundation. Our goal is to be a community, not to be your favorite community organization. So we often talk that support is free, but it also takes resources to support others. So whether that be your social influence and having the opportunity to share our website, whether it's taking the opportunity to like us on Facebook, I don't stand here to be acknowledged as an individual. I stand here as proxy for the future adults who impact my life every day, who don't get invitations to sit on panels. And when they do, we put them there if they feel comfortable. But I say that to say we believe in leaderful spaces. We believe in organizing, advocating, and creating a future worth fighting for. And I wanted to close with an invitation for you to join us and check out our work. Our website is so easy. It's www.thefuturedc.org. And I'll just say we were one of the only organizations that didn't have to change their strategic plan because Trump was elected. We were already doing the work and doing it the way it needed to be done. I don't shame organizations that are almost $100 million richer because we don't teach popular education. But I will remind you that it will be popular education that will work to liberate us. And just ask you all to further research who you support and how you support them, because we all don't have the brand recognition.
Thank you. Okay, so I will read our quote from group 6. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. And this was why I am opposed to the war in Vietnam in 1967. We had, our group had a discussion more so around just the pieces. We kind of pulled the pieces out separately. We started thinking about what does it mean to have a rapid shift in 1967. This was called for by Martin Luther King, to now, you know, how does that inform us now? It's kind of put us back. If you think about, you know, clearly has not happened. So where we are now is still thing-oriented society. Where do we move forward from there? And our group had, you know, a very, very good discussion about, you know, what does it look like to do the work? What does it look like to have a different perspective on Martin Luther King's legacy? Some members of our group were from outside the country. And so we had that discussion, whereas Dr. King's ideas are not necessarily new, even the most radical ones. You know, they have a legacy of their own in you know, anti-capitalist and sociology circles. His ideas came from somewhere. And so, you know, outside of the US, outside of, you know, this room, those ideas are well and live. But when we prop up and when we whitewash and when we, what did we say? Yeah, we said whitewash. When we whitewash the figurehead, people kind of lose people who may have been invested in the same kind of fight, in the same kind of way that MLK was invested in this country. When they come to this country from other places and they know a legacy of Marx and they know a legacy of you know, other revolutionary activists who spoke on capitalism, who spoke on these same issues, they don't have the same affinity with the people here who are doing the work, because that's not what was presented to a larger audience outside of the US. And I'll give the perfect example, because Mr. Alonzo spoke about after Martin Luther King's assassination, being a petition being circulated about, you know, making his birthday a national holiday. And at the time, Mr. Alonzo spoke on the Black news media that did not want a national holiday, that instead wanted a national day of strike. And what that presentation to the, you know, the US as a global entity, what that presentation does to the legacy of MLK and how now the world is looking at MLK as just this nice, you know, everybody has a dream and everybody can make it. And it's a nationalized holiday and everybody celebrates, but there's no real meat behind that. And so some of the other questions, we talked about whether or not it, we didn't really get into whether or not it reclaimed, but we did definitely get into the complex understandings of what he was getting at. We talked about, you know, what it means to take an extra step. Because there's the first step that is, you know, everybody having a dream and the first step that everybody can agree on that we should all have, you know, equality. And then there's a second step where it is the anti-capitalist perspective, where it is the radical race relations perspective and what it looks like to really take that extra step and use it to inform our work today and to build community around what it really looks like to have a more just world. And I didn't take notes because I wanted us to really have a good conversation. And I think that as a facilitator, I felt that. But I do want to leave in closing because I particularly do this work a lot around you know, my work in anti-racism work in sociology. And I think what something else that was brought up in the group and also was brought up here was that Martin Luther King was in the business of changing hearts and minds. And so I think that and someone on the panel, I believe, brought up his sense of humanism that came from his role in theology because he was a priest. And I think that one place that we could start and start to inform our work now is with reflexive sociology, what they taught in schools, reflexive sociology. And it begins with looking at where am I now? Where do we need to go? Where do we need to go? And then where do I need to go for us to get there? Because we all have work to do. Each and every one of us has work to do. And we can't get to that place. And we can't, the example that Mr. Alonzo used again, thank you for being my great example. You know, as many bombs, as many planes, as many drones you can buy, if you cannot pay somebody, let's put it in the context of capitalism, you can't pay somebody to operate that plane because their heart and mind is not, you know, for your goal, then it doesn't matter how many you buy because you're not gonna win. And so I think that, you know, as individuals, all of us, the work that we have to do is really show that we're aware that there is a more just world that is possible and that we know that we're the ones that, you know, need to work there to get there, whether that's our generation, you know, my generation, youngers, you know, moving it forward and the older generation supporting. Whatever it looks like, I think that it looks like, you know, all of us kind of doing some internal work and then letting that just shine outwards. And follow up, if you want to follow me, if you want to connect with me, I'd love to have open up this conversation more. I can be followed at BaseClacky on Twitter because I know y'all are doing the Twitter thing. So please look me up and shout me out. I would love to have more conversation with all of you. Thank you all for coming.
So I was so, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to take away from your claps. I was so engrossed in like the panel. I just noticed we're 15 minutes over. So I wanted to take a temperature check. Is it okay if we take 10 more minutes? Is that all right with the room? I know we all have busy days tomorrow. Is that good? All right, so we can keep on with this pace. You all can say what you need to say. Perfect.
Okay, so I'm going to be pretty quick. Okay, so I have to confess, we went kind of rogue. So we really kind of
non-conformist.
You know, so on the question, so I'm gonna pretend like we did.
Actually, it's just there to help you if you need to, you know, to help you grow, to grow what you need, where you need to go. To help pull the vines up, but if it doesn't, go where you need to. So.
Okay, all right, we've been liberated. So we did have a wide ranging, very rich engagement and discussion about a range of things. Some coming off of the discussions earlier and some coming off the readings and some coming off of what came up in the group. We talked about whitewashing King, but that wasn't just King. When you look at like Mandela, for example. So there's a long history of the struggle over the interpretation and meaning and significance of people who play leading roles in our struggles. And that's ongoing. And so we have to continue that and be vigilant and aware of that always. We also talked about why King was not popular during his time and what were the challenges that King faced, and that when you struggle, it becomes a challenge. And it often leads to people being marginalized and, of course, people coming under attack. And this recognition that we have to address that. One of our group members insightfully informed us that she had went back and looked at Martin Luther King's interviews on Meet the Press. That a few years ago, they had put these up in archives. And as she pointed out in very instructive kinds of ways, when you look at King and his interviews in that period, the way in which King was treated really is instructive, because we think of King as, you know, a hero. We think of King as someone kind of above, you know, who would dare attack King? But that's exactly what they did. And they treated King in very condescending, very insulting kinds of ways. And that's a lesson, I think, because that's what happens when you challenge power, right? And King certainly didn't back down when all of that kind of came up. We spent a lot of time, of the little time we had, talking about social media and counter narratives and what are the possibilities of using social media in ways in which we challenge these dominant narratives about how we think about power, how we think about struggle, how we think about social change. And, you know, certainly that didn't exist during the time of King, certainly not exist now. But there are ways in which we kind of have to break into that. A lot of the discussion also went to looking at working class issues, and that it's not only about issues of race and those kinds of struggles, but in a broader context, particularly where we're at now, how do we understand class as a variable in the struggles we have to engage in now? What did that mean for last year's elections? Right? What does that mean for this year's struggle? And so all of that, we batted around, and I thought we had a very good exchange. More? My people?
No, I think you did a really good job of kind of bringing all of our thoughts and all of the tangents that we went off on and bringing them together into one kind of unified theme.
Just in closing statement, very simple. I think we have to do more of this. I disagree with, you know, like 100% of what Jeb Bush has actually had said and done in his life. But the one thing he said last year that was instructive was when he called Trump a chaos candidate. And if you elect a chaos candidate, you get chaos government. But it's chaos with a purpose. And that purpose, I would argue, is to establish an authoritarian government that weakens or demolishes democratic institutions and democratic norms. And we're in the fight of our lives around these issues, right? The barriers to the kind of, in just 2 weeks, behavior that we're seeing coming from this administration should be alarming. This is why the rest of the world is alarmed, because they know what happens when all those institutions disappear and you end up with the kind of states that you see that takes decades to recover from. So we need to do all of this and more, because we're going to be battling every single day that these guys are in power in the White House and in Congress and these state houses. And so, you know, I applaud, you know, IPS. I certainly support, you know, the work that all the panelists are doing. And this is what we're going to be doing. You know, this is going to be us for the foreseeable future.
Last but not least, I will try to be succinct. I promise that. Our quote was, "A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual doom. Martin Luther King Jr., where do we go from here? Chaos or community?" We basically went through this quote. We didn't even get to the other quotes and answered all the questions that you laid out. how does it inform current American policy and politics today? We as a group decided that pretty much as a society, we're entering spiritual doom. And by spiritual doom, we really meant not a religious doom, but a doom of community, where we value consumerism and we value things more than we value people, more than we value one another, more than we value the earth, quite frankly. So we talked very briefly about how after 9/11, we were told to go out and spend money, not go home and sit with your children, not go tend to the elderly in your communities, but go out and spend money. So that's kind of the spiritual doom that this military complex has put on us as a country. We then talked a little bit about a budget being a moral document and not just a document of dollars and cents. Where you spend money is what you value. I talked a little bit about that from my experience as being in policy. I deal in legislature and we talk about it all the time. We spend more than half of our budget on education. So clearly that's what we value. We spend a few dollars on HHS or what we call safety net services, and we fight for those dollars every day. And every budget, I mean, $10,000 literally in a $2 billion budget. And so just basically talking about how we can use, how basically spending tells us where we are as a nation, as a state, as a municipality. Remind me of your name again.
Yasmina.
Yasmina talked about going and doing her organizing and laying out the money or the budget for the people she's working with. And you know, when she says, hey, this is what's going on and this is how it's happening, and if people don't believe her, saying, hey, these are the dollars. These are the dollars that went to your council member. These are the dollars that came from this developer. These are the dollars that went to this particular person or that particular person. Follow the money, follow the ethics, follow the morals is what it came down to for us. I think there's a quote, reclaim MLK. We thought as a group, this was, I think maybe we're more informed. We thought this was consistent with who he is. He is a preacher. He is a humanist. And a spiritual life or a spiritual betterment was clearly what he was about. And so we thought that this was consistent with what we knew as king. But we definitely talked about the commercialization of king, kind of the sugary sweet image that we've been sold and how different this was from that image. Please jump in. I know I'm gonna forget something. How does this quote inform your work in your community? And I guess that just goes back to the budget as a moral document. Anything else, guys? I know I forgot something. We had a really rich conversation. And I guess for my closing statement, I would just say, in the work I've done, both policy and youth work and in union work, I've often been like, why haven't you all told the young people? I remember walking into the AFL-CIO my early 20s and finding out like the whole benefit structure, finding out about what was expected when the union movement was in its heyday, and going into my boss's office and literally closing the door and saying, you have millions of young people who think a 401k is something. Why haven't you told them? Why haven't we told people that a 1% match on your 401k really isn't squat? So we have young people who don't even have the expectation, who don't ever feel entitled to a better life, to a better way. So my closing statement is, take all this, process it, and then go find some young people to talk to this about. Go find young people and tell them to question everything, to question and read everything. Teach them to think critically. I work with teens, 13 to 19, and I've been doing it for 10 years officially, but I've been doing it probably my whole life unofficially. And it always strikes me that people are upset with young people when they don't know or when they can't perform. And I always say, but have we taught them? Mm-hmm. But have we taught them? We haven't taught them. And it's not enough to sit here and have this conversation with each other. We have to teach young people that this is not
you can't go along to get along. And this expecting to struggle is not, it's not your lot in life. It's not your lot in life. So that's my closing statement. Go reach and tell some young people that they deserve more, that they're owed more in this country.
If we could have a round of applause for the panel. And hearing, Mimi, any words from Winston-Salem? Oh, wonderful. Okay. So if you check out again, hashtag reclaim MLK at IPS_DC, you can check out their comments. Make sure that you check out King's Dream Still Is a Reality. That's an op-ed written by my very good brother, Kenneth Worrells. The tagline is, now is the time to open the doors of opportunity to all of God's children. It talks about that Black people obviously don't have economic justice in any way, and part of that is represented through the way that we don't have any home ownership. Also check out our racial wealth gap report, which among other things shows that the wealth of the Forbes 400 richest Americans has grown by an average of 736%, and which is the wealthiest 100 members of this list alone own about as much wealth as the entire African-American population combined.
That's an incredible report. Yeah.
And that it will take 228 years for the average Black family to amass the same amount of wealth as the average white family today. So please check out those reports. And before we leave, I have two things. One is I have a survey out there. And it's not just a survey for survey's sake or data. It's actually something that we are going to use as the Black History Month Planning Committee and as IPS to make these events more accessible, more intergenerational, more engaging, and have action steps involved. So please fill it out front to back. It will help me so that I know what you all are thinking, because I don't want to assume. Mm-hmm. I want to know what people are thinking, what can make this better. There's questions about childcare, all that kind of stuff. So please answer it. And before we leave, if we could just take a moment of silence for our ancestors, for the unsung, for the sung, for the unclaimed, for the claimed, and also for those who, for whatever reason, can't be here with us tonight. All right, y'all. Have a good night. Let's go forward. Let's continue the struggle and the fights that we're in. Positivity and love, y'all. Solidarity.